Hello, this is Nivriti Rai. I'm the country head for Intel India, and I'm really looking forward to have a conversation with you.
And hello, this is Madhu Bhandari from Network 18. Welcome to our special one-on-one conversation series where we are talking to newsmakers about business and life in the times of dealing with a global pandemic. Now, over the past month and a half, what has kept us afloat through successive lockdowns and through embracing social distancing norms is perhaps technology. And when it comes to either staying in touch with our loved ones around the world or whether it comes to working from home, a lot of us have been totally dependent on technology. So today, Nivriti and I are going to be talking about how we can use technology to battle COVID-19. Nivriti, thank you so much for taking our time and being with us here today. Let me first ask you, as the country head of Intel in India, how challenging has it been to work from home? Or do you think that, you know, the IT sector was perhaps the best poised amongst all sectors to really take this work from home norm to scale?
So I agree with you that IT sector, I think, is the most prepared. Because if you look at some of the tools that we are using have been in existence for a while. But during this time, I think we've stretched the use, like we've never done before. For example, VPN access. In Intel, we have tremendous amount of tunnels that can enable almost everybody to work through VPN. But we tested during these lockdown times. So yes, we were most prepared. But has it been challenging? Oh, absolutely. It has been very challenging.
Right, indeed, it has been challenging for all of us. But as far as managing COVID-19 is concerned, tech companies have been doing a lot on that front. As far as Intel is concerned, what are some of the most impactful initiatives that you've taken both internally within the company for the benefit of employees and externally to battle COVID-19 around the world?
So we are doing quite a few things, Mritu, but one thing that really stands out, and I'm counting on the value of this, is our engagement with CSIR as well as IIIT Hyderabad. So what we are working on is how do we make diagnostics affordable, fast, and scalable. So we are working with CSIR and coming up with technology which will enable the testing, whether it is from RT-PCR, whether it is from Oxford Nanopore, or it is from simple things like a blood test which tells you about the antibodies and in a way, tell you whether you had a COVID-19 or not. All of this, imagine if it could be done way faster because we have the ability to drive large scale analytics and AI-based solutions such that, instead of coming up with a result which takes 4 hours, it will take, something like 2 hours, or for blood tests, it will take 15 minutes and with higher accuracy. So not only diagnostics, but the ability to build vaccine is what we are trying to work with CSIR as well as IIIT Hyderabad.
That brings me to my next question, which is that you are also heading the COVID-19 task force at NASSCOM. What is the agenda that this task force has set out with? What is on the immediate agenda for this task force, and what's the road ahead looking like? What are you hoping to achieve over the next, say, 3 to 6 months?
First of all, I must tell you, it is wonderful to work, with industries together with one goal in mind, which is India and humanity. None of the companies are pushing forward that, hey, put my logo or tell people that, this is Wipro or this is Mindtree or this is TCS or this is AWS. People are just coming together to build this platform. And what this platform is, it's a very interesting platform. It enables data to come into the cloud through apps. And we are building few apps in addition to Arogya Setu. We call it Arogya Seva. So people who don't even have smartphones, their information can be put into this data lake, which is basically a large cloud. So apps, data movement into this data lake. This data lake then driving decisions for administration of the city, making sure that we have safe zone marked, where people can travel. We also do the supply chain matching, so hospitals, beds to patients. So it's an end-to-end solution. And all the companies, like 40 some companies, have come under the NASSCOM aegis to build this solution. And I'm really looking forward to piloting this in Karnataka. We've also used this in Maharashtra and also working with the central government and partnering with them. The intention is not to come with anything parallel. The intention is to continue contributing and seeing where it can be of help to the country and to the government, both central and state.
How soon are these dashboards going to be available to citizens?
You know, the dashboard, this minute we enter the data into this solution, the dashboards can be available, because we've done the entire framework, we built the architecture. It's based on what is called open source architecture. So APIs have been created, more apps can be linked to it. And we've also made it multi-cloud. So, you know, nobody will be unhappy that, oh, my cloud is a CSIR cloud. Can you plug that in? Yes, we can. I am using AWS cloud, or I'm using a ControlS cloud. So it enables multi-cloud in the backend. It has smart AI-based analytics to drive many kinds of predictions. And then it enables data through, you know, our population, through multiple apps, whether they have cell phones or not.
Let me also talk to you as a business leader about digital transformation. That's from here on. When you look at a post-COVID-19 world, how should India Inc. reshape its digital transformation journey at this point in time to be prepared for a post-COVID-19 world?
You know, the basic needs we have is food, is safety, security, is health, is our occupation, and then comes leisure activity. Honestly, Mridu, technology will play a part in every single one, and growth, for example. In the case, I'm going to start with growth. Growth will happen through education for children, through employment for MSMEs. You know, we have 98% of employment through MSMEs and only 2-3% through these large companies. So whether it is education, whether it is MSME, or whether it is large companies, growth is going to be requiring the base or platform of technology.
And finally, as a remote and virtual leader of an India-wide workforce, what lessons in leadership have you learned over the last couple of weeks of lockdown? How are you keeping this digital workforce of yours inspired on a daily basis?
So the first thing is, I relook and reassess my roles, goals, my skills, and my capacity. That's number one. Number two is, I really think that we have to increase the personal interaction. It is so important, you know, to see you on a screen is very different from, you know, hearing your voice and the kind of assurance a leader can give through the gestures, through the expressions is priceless. So time right now requires us to be more available and leverage some of these technologies so people can see. We have to readjust to the new norms of how we are working.
Absolutely. New normal is going to be very important. And like you said, perhaps compassion is the only thing that's going to get us all through this together. And I do hope that you're right and we all turn out better and more positive people at the end of this pandemic. Thank you so much, Nivruti, for taking out time and being with us here today. Well, that's a wrap of this special conversation on our one-on-one conversation series. I'll be back next time with another newsmaker talking about business and life in the times of dealing with a global pandemic. Thanks very much for joining us today. Goodbye.